Hey everybody, thanks for being here. Today we're in beautiful British Columbia fishing for kokanee in Wood Lake and Kalamalka Lake. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned.
I'm Justin Wolf and this is Angler West Television.
The Okanogan Valley of British Columbia stretches for well over 100 miles to the north of the U.S. border of north-central Washington, an area famous for ski resorts and for its many wineries in and around Kelowna, the largest city in the region. Okanogan Lake itself looks tempting, but on this trip we're going to explore two other close-by fisheries, Wood Lake, that's currently producing excellent quality kokanee, and its neighbor Kalamalka Lake, which is a favorite of trophy hunters looking for big lake trout, rainbows, and kokanee in the 4 to 5 pound range. The two lakes are connected by a short canal, giving access to boaters. Along with Bob Loomis and Lance Merz of Mack's Lure, who are in their own boat, we've launched in Kalamalka Lake, but we'll be fishing in Wood Lake. We're with Steve Lynch of Procure and local angler Jim Sutherland. We'll pass through the canal into Wood Lake, where cool springtime water temperatures should have the kokanee near the surface.
First thing, we're going to try and get something right off the surface. Those fish should be right up here right now. They should be on the surface.
Okay.
So first thing, we just run two top lines and see what happens. That's all we can do.
Works for me. Okay.
First of all, seeing I think those fish are probably high, we're just running a simple Mack flashlight and a wetting bait. Should work about as good as anything this morning, picked them up. Okay. Naturally, we've got to have a little bit of Procure corn on here. Steve was good enough to mix up for us this morning, but just a very, very simple Mack rig.
The corn we did up with the kokanee corn magic, it drained the juice off the corn and then stirred just maybe a quarter of a teaspoon of the kokanee corn magic for the can of corn. Drained off the excess juice, and then what we're going to do today is split it up and pre-set them into about four different types of sets. But for right now, we're just going to start out plain and kind of dabble them here and there and see what they want.
These can be.
I'm going to do pretty much the same setup as Jim, but I'm just going to put a thin bead of scent right on the outside of the spinner blade. And you want to put it on the outside, that way when you're trolling slow, the scent, if you put it on the inside of the blade, can get caught up in the beads and stop the spinner from spinning. So just a light smear of it on the outside, and this will last about 30 minutes putting out scent.
You know, just run it out about 70, 80 feet. And these top rigs that we're running now, the water's still fairly cool. These fish should be up fairly high, and they will come up to strike.
Okay.
So we're just covering about the top 15 feet of water, and we'll know within 10 or 15 minutes if there's in this area. Now, when I was out the other day, this is both the area that the fish were hitting, and this is just where I start if I'm alone. The reason I use a ball troll is I think it takes away from the spooking of the cannonballs. It just, that's 10 pounds of fish that's running through the water now instead of just a cannonball running through the water. And kokanee, I found, they're attracted to that extra flash.
Right at that 75 feet.
In the boat.
First one. Woohoo!
That's a little smaller than average, but that fish will eat like a son of a gun. It might be a three-year-old fish instead of a four-year-old fish. That might explain why it's smaller. But this fish, by this summer, will gain at least an inch and a half, maybe even 2 inches, and probably half a pound in weight. But this, if somebody wants a couple fillets, this is just a tremendous eaten fish.
So this is our new super sauce. It's the shrimp flavored. So this is real shrimp that we put in. We color the gel. And I'm just putting it on the outside of the spinner blade.
Right at the moment we're top lining, these fish are right up on top. So we just put a Mack flashlight on, just a rudder to keep everything from tangling, and then a simple wetting band. And as you've seen, these fish right up on top like that, this probably isn't running 2-3 feet deep.
Welcome back to Wood Lake in southern British Columbia. I'm Justin Wolf. We've landed our first fish of the day, but the bite still seems a little slow. The fish just aren't in a feeding mode, so let's try a good old-fashioned Canadian bucktail trolling fly behind a double D dodger. With its buoyancy and shape working for it, the fly is given great action by the dodger, which just might fire up these fish to give us a reaction strike.
No lie, this hadn't been down the bottom 30 seconds. You got that net, Jim?
We got a net. Okay. That's just a little bit of a better one.
Yeah.
We just tied on a little fly, put it about 9 inches behind a double D dodger, put a little Berkeley Power bait on it, some Pro-Cure over that, and literally within minutes.
1 minute. I mean, it was within one minute. Yeah. Let's try it again.
See, there's a good chance that this one is a 3-year-old fish, and this one is a 4-year-old fish. They're just a little size different. Now, you give this one another couple months, that's going to be a nice kokanee in anybody's book. And seeing I got friends at Pro-Cure, I don't stint on the Pro-Cure. What I do, that these kokanee are hitting so soft this morning, and these you need a soft rod for kokanee. A lot of times I'll just put them in the downrigger clip the same as usual, and it makes them, it's not quite so giving.
Okay.
And it just sometimes, not always, but sometimes it really helps with the hookup. I just connect an Oregon tackle school of fish to the ball, then put an ultra release behind that, and then just troll off that. And I'm back about 11 to 18 feet. This kind of brings the fish in. Then they find the following lure presentation. But you don't have to fight this. You're only fighting basically the fish in a small presentation. When I'm top lining like this, I go with a little stiffer rod. I feel I get a little better hook set from it. Okay, like a Lamaglass 801, it's just a little stiffer. A regular kokanee rod I go to on the downriggers because you got that much more limber on these fish that are in here. In BC, you can't put them in a live well or try and keep them alive in any way. Basically, once they're in the boat, they're dead fish. Put them in your Yeti cooler with some ice. Take them home. Look at that rod. That's an 801, and these fish are still working that rod.
Oh,
that little double D, and we're just running it straight, not offset. We're running it straight, and that's only about 9 inches. It's really putting the whip, and then that extra little bit of tail on there, just, well, you can see the triggering action.
Yeah, it sure hooked this one good. Look at that, through it, it's got them all sealed shut.
Limit here is 2 kokanee each.
A little bit of goo, the trout kokanee magic, it's going to be working.
Up next, we'll jump in the boat with Bobby and Lance from Mack's Lure, who've been having a great morning, even releasing a few. Steve Lynch and Jim Sutherland are putting some nice kokanee in the boat after a few adjustments to their presentation. Bob Loomis and Lance Merz are also fishing Wood Lake with success, but they too had to make the right adjustments to draw reaction strikes.
This is what we've been catching most fish on this morning, is one of our double whammy kokanee pros. And the fish seem to want a little bit more of a reactionary movement, you know, trying to really coax them into jumping on it. So is what I did is I actually took our 1.1 smile blade off and I put the 1.5 on to give it a lot more movement, as well as shorten the leader down. Once we did that, I mean, we just absolutely started catching the heck out of the fish. I mean, it was a night and day difference. So, you know, trying to get different types of movement, you can do it a number of different ways, whether you're shortening your leaders down, whether you're going to stiffer leaders, larger diameter leaders, or adding in that larger smile blade in order to get that different movement to entice those fish to want to hit. So that worked real well for us today.
What depth is it at?
25 feet.
25?
Okay. Come on, baby. They're really light biters. But once you got them hooked, man, you can see the bend in this rod.
Really a good light action rod.
Uh-oh.
Come off.
You ready?
Yeah. Got him.
So this is a little different rig than what Bobby was talking about. I'm running a Double D Dodger, and I've got some basically moon jelly tape on the Dodger itself. A little bit of a modification, but it's still doesn't affect the action of the Dodger itself. We're also fishing a cha-cha kokanee squitter. We've got 2 size 4 hooks on, and we've been kind of playing around with the hooks. They're seeming to like the pink colored hooks. And then we've got a 1.1 UV glow smile blade, and that pink has really been hot this morning. So, and then tipped with some white shoe peg corn with some Procure anise, and it's been catching a lot of fish.
The speed we've been playing with this morning, we've been running 1.5 has been our best speed. You get up over 1.6 and didn't do nearly as well. You got underneath 1.4 and we didn't do nearly as well. So that 1.5 has kind of been our magic speed this morning. So it's kind of difficult because you have to account for the wind and everything else, and you're trying to run a straight line in the wind or against it, and it becomes a little trial and error till you get it all dialed in. But that 1.5 speed has really been our best number this morning.
I'm putting on 2 pieces of corn per hook. It's the cheapest thing on the boat, so why not load it up.
Good quality kokanee corn is critical to success, as the corn is the bait that the fish are actually biting and not the lure itself, which is, after all, the lure and not the bait. Now here's Steve Lynch on how to prepare perfect kokanee corn.
Today I'm going to show you how we're curing up our corn for kokanee fishing. Last night we did this up with a pink kokanee corn magic. Today I'm going to go through and show with a clear kokanee corn magic. And all you're going to do is drain off the juice on your corn into a colander. It's important to use a strainer when doing this. A lot of people just take the lid from the can and press it down to get the oil out. And what that's doing is squishing the corn. So I like to put mine into a colander, let them drip any excess juice, and then I'll put them into a smaller container. So once the juice has been drained off, all you have to do is add about 1/4 teaspoon of the Wizard Kokanee Corn Magic. And all I'll do is put a little bit, lightly sprinkle it, and then with gloves on, or with a plastic fork, you can just stir it around. But I myself just like to put on a pair of gloves. That way, if I'm doing the pink, it doesn't stain my hands, or the chemicals won't tear my hands up. And all I'm gonna do is just lightly stir it around, and then I'll add a little bit more to it. And what this will do it's come morning, this will rejuice up again. So this is something you want to do at least the night before you're going to fish. Drain your juice off, put it in here, put the chemical on it, and then it will rejuice the corn up. So in the morning, I'll re-drain the juice, and then I'll split it up into smaller containers and add my scent to it. But it's quite simple. Takes less than 2 minutes from start to finish. And here again, all I do is just lightly stir it around. You cannot put too much on these. It won't burn them, shrivel them up. So in my case, more is better. But what this will do is it will dry the corn out, firm it up, and allows it where it doesn't slime up on you the next day when you're fishing. So as long as you keep this cold or on ice or out of the direct heat, when you're done fishing at the end of the day, you'll just re-drain off your juice, put it in back in your sealed container, and put it in the shelf in your refrigerator. And this will hold up till the next trip out. And what I mean by that, even 2 or 3 weeks down the road, this will still be firm in your refrigerator and usable. So no need to pitch it at the end of the day. Okay, after I've put the Wizard Kokanee Corn Magic on the corn, I'm gonna put it into smaller containers, and then what I can do is put scent in with it. So that way I can have pre-scented different types of corn. So instead of just having one type, I'm gonna go out with 4 different baits the following morning. So all I do is just put a little bit in each container. So some of the best scents for kokanee fishing, we have the Kokanee Special, which is a blend of 5 different fish oils. The tuna's been very hot. The anise bloody tuna, hands down, has been the most popular and the most effective. But the plain tuna has been working very well. And then in the afternoons and evenings, I go to the garlic tuna. Seems like anything garlic related has been very hot in the afternoons. And all I do is just, after it's been separated in smaller containers, I just put a little bit of the fish oil in, and I make sure I label it so I'll know which one is which. But it doesn't take a lot. So all it is just a small squirt of the oil. And then I'll put the lid on it, put it in the refrigerator, or even I've left my bait at home before, so I'll a lot of times just put it in my bait cooler in the boat now, so I'm ready to go for in the morning.
Welcome back to the Okanogan Valley area of southern British Columbia. I'm Justin Wolfe. We fished Wood Lake yesterday, but today we're going to explore the adjacent Kalamalka Lake, which means the lake of many colors due to the color phenomenon that happen as the lake clears in the summer. Kalamalka is known to grow large fish, including trophy-sized lake trout and rainbows, as well as kokanee to 4 or 5 pounds. Today we're going to put down a variety of lures to try to hook up with one of these larger fish. We'll start with a Brad Superbait behind a Double D Dodger deep for lake trout or rainbows, and another rod set shallow for kokanee.
We'll just try a Brad bait in a kokanee color down deep. Never know, might take a big rainbow or we might take a lake trout here. We'll just run that blackjack in behind a Double D Dodger, just something to give a little extra flash and attraction down there. Now I'm just using my corn, and I just put a little buildup inside it. It's been marinated in some procure sauce. One of the problems with fishing these lakes when you're trying to use your depth sounder is there's so many different species of fish in here, you have to ask yourself, what are you fishing for? And sometimes you have to use your gut feeling, your intuition to target specific fish. Here we can, it might be perch, it might be whitefish, squawfish, who knows, lake trout, rainbows. Target what you're after and you're going to do way better.
There we go. That's what we're looking for.
Ha ha! You don't want them better folks?
Yeah, just a little better. Oh. I'll bring them to you, Jim.
Easy, easy. That's one of them bigger. That's the one in a day. That's the one in a day. Just shy of 20 inches. Just. But when you put that on the floor, it isn't jumping all over. Look at the depth to this for these kokanee. Look at that for a depth. Yep. That fish is 5.5 inches, just top to bottom. It's just under 20, it's just 19.
Okay. Oh, I'm calling that 20. I don't care about you. That's a US 20 all day long.
Okay. Good man.
Nice fish, thank
you,
sir.
Good man.
We got a double header,
not necessarily big fish, but there is a double header on the go here, guys. Mine's still on.
Yeah, a couple babies.
On.
You better the last one.
Yeah, these are double header. These are the little shore spawners. This is what the rainbows and the Lakers eat in here. Various bodies of water in the Okanogan, you have what they call shore spawners. And this is an average shore spawner. They're normally around 10 inches long. Very seldom any bigger. A stream spawner is traditionally a bigger fish. The stream spawners are the ones that we are getting that are taking up in the 4 or 5 pounds. That one big one we caught today, that, the odds are, was a stream spawner. These are the shore spawners, and these are what is giving the big fish in this area what makes them grow. This lake will produce 40-pound lake trout. They'll eat 5 to 10 of these a day.
Hey, thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, the show would not be possible. So please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.